Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, I'm going to read from Exodus 19. This is what God says to Israel once they reach Mount Sinai. Yahweh called to Moses out of the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob and tell the people of Israel, you yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you will indeed listen to my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the people of Israel." So Moses came and called the elders of the people and set before them all these words that Yahweh had commanded. All the people answered together and said, "All that Yahweh has spoken, we will do." Sure they will. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we ask that you would send your Holy Spirit upon us so that by your grace we may believe your holy word and live holy lives according to it. In Jesus' name, amen. So the key words here, at least for me, is that, okay, no. There's kind of two parts to it. One is the half part of Israel being people, Israel being God's people, and Israel saying that you are our God. Okay. That's the line I love almost more than any other in the Bible, is when God says to his people, "You are my people and I am your God." And Israel and God's people say to God, "We are your people and you are our God." And so what does that look like? It's these words: "We are a kingdom of priests and a holy nation." Now, this was given to Israel specifically, but later on, Peter is going to say that we are a holy nation and a royal priesthood. This is God's plan. This is the gospel, or God's big story in a nutshell, that we are to be a kingdom of priests, a holy nation. And I think those words mean basically the same thing, you know, being a holy nation, a nation that is set apart for God's purposes. The word holy, it's really, I don't want to say it has nothing to do with morality, but you can be immoral and holy. For God, you know, morality is part of holiness, but it starts with holiness. It starts with being set apart for God's purposes. It starts with God's calling, God's vocation for us. And that is to be a kingdom of priests, a royal priesthood. And what does a priest do? A priest connects. He reflects the image of God. He reflects God to the people around him, and then reflects people back to God. And so, a priest is a mediator, an intercessor, an intermediary, a mediator between God and people, a go-between between God and people. What one person in the men's breakfast said, we're a gopher. Go do this, go do that. Go for this, go for that. You notice Moses always running back and forth between God. And he's, you know, Moses goes up to God and God says, "Tell the people this." Moses goes down and he says, "This is what God says." Then he runs back to God and says, "This is what the people say." And God says, "Tell the people this." And Moses runs back down. He's running back and forth, up and down the mountain. One commentator, he said, "It took me 4 hours. And there's one time where Moses has to wait 7 days for God to talk. He just kind of chills with God for 7 days. And then God goes, "So Moses, here's what I have to say to you." Gotta love it. So this is what I kind of want to center the message around today, is this idea of what it means to be God's mediators, God's image bearers, because I'm going to throw a lot at you. And this is a long section, 19 through 31. It's a long section, but I've got this constant dilemma between, you know, covering a lot of material, you know, kind of being a mile wide and an inch deep, and being an inch deep and a mile, inch wide and a mile deep, you know, because we could read through the whole Bible in a year. That's a little bit less than 4 chapters a day to cover that. So, you know, whatever that would be, you know, 25 chapters 25 chapters a week, something like that. That's a lot of material to cover. And it's kind of in one ear, out the other. I did that. I've done that every year for decades. And it's in one ear, out the other. The other is we could spend 7 years in Exodus and still just barely be scratching the surface and go, you know, really deep into Exodus. But that's not my goal. My goal is partly I would like to do things seasonally, and we're in the resurrection season. So we're doing a resurrection story, which is what Exodus is. It's a story of death and rebirth, or slavery and freedom. But then also I like to read whole books. And so that means covering them fairly quickly, you know, and going a little deep. My hope is you're going to read God's word, and you're going to read, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4 chapters a day, and study and learn, you know, spend 20, 30 minutes a day reading God's word, listening to your heavenly Father's voice, and then gather with brothers and sisters in Christ to eat together and to encourage each other with the word of God and speak what God has spoken to you, so that we can go deeper into God's word together, so that we can learn God's story and how, not how God's word applies to us, but how we apply, how we fit into God's big story that he's telling. So that's why I do what I do with, you know, reading whole books of the Bible. And we just got a big chunk, so I'm going to throw a lot at you right now. But I think it all is part and parcel of a theme. So let's start with God. Did you notice the picture of God, you know, up to this point in Exodus? You know, especially chapters 19 and 20, God is this, wow, thunder, lightning, powerful, majestic, scary. The people are trembling in fear. Moses, how about you talk to us? Leave God up there and you talk to us, okay? We'll just do whatever you say. And some people, they say God is, you know, the God of the Old Testament is a God of wrath. What? Are you reading the same story I am? Because I don't think you are. You know, God is vindictive and wrathful and judgmental and always striking people down. But so far in this story, God has struck no one down without giving them opportunity to escape first. He gave fair warning, and he delayed and delayed. When it says, God says, I am slow to anger, I believe it. Because I'm looking at it going, wow, you are slow to anger. At least that's the way I'm reading the story. But nonetheless, God is portrayed here as scary. He's not, you know, the friend of sinners and tax collectors that Jesus is. Nor is he this buddy-buddy, chummy, personal friend, teddy bear, squeezably soft God that some people apparently have. No, he's a big, scary God. And this is an accurate portrayal of God, as is Jesus, the friend of sinners. But right now, we have this big, scary God, and we've got Moses, who's this go-between. I always get a kick out of Moses and God, because they've got an interesting relationship. I really want to explore it more and talk to people more about it. Because, you know, Moses says to Pharaoh, hey, when do you want this plague done? Hey, tomorrow. And so Moses goes and says, hey, God, why don't you let up on that plague? And God goes, oh, okay, whatever you say, Moses. What? God is doing what Moses tells him to? And then this whole go-between, you know, Moses running up and down the mountain saying, here's what God says. Here's what the people say. Here's what God says. Here's what the people say. It's like, couldn't God have just listened in on the conversation? Why does he need this intermediary? And the answer is the mediators, the priests of God, the people of Israel, who are called to be a holy nation and a royal priesthood. They are called to be intermediaries between God and each other, between God and the people around them, the nations around them. It's just that the mediator needs a mediator between God and people. And who is that mediator ultimately? It's not Moses. Yeah, if you remember Sunday school lesson, the answer is Jesus. Jesus becomes that mediator between God and humans. God finally has to say, I have to do this myself. I have to show you what a true human is really like. And so it's this royal priesthood. So Exodus chapter 20. It's funny. I went to a confirmation seminar or something, and the guy says, you know, to his confirmands, if you remember nothing else from confirmation, remember Exodus 19 comes before Exodus 20. That is, God says, I delivered you. I rescued you on eagle's wings. I don't think that the Israelites would have seen their hunger and thirst and scary situation with the Egyptian army, you know, and being travel weary. I don't think they would have seen that as eagle's wings. But that's how God sees it. God is a rescuing, delivering God. However scary he might be, however distant he is, however non-chummy, non-friendly, he is a rescuing, delivering God. But then look what he's doing with Moses and the people of Israel. Why is he standing off so far? Why does he send Moses to do his work? And the answer is because Moses is a priest to the priests. He's a mediator to the mediators. Because the mediators need a mediator because we are full of sin. And I want you to see this in Exodus chapter 20. God spoke all these words saying, oh, by the way, so the Ten Commandments, they're never called commandments. They're called the Ten Words later on in Exodus and a couple times in Deuteronomy. They're called the Ten Words, and the word can be translated, you know, Ten Words, Ten Things, Ten Matters, something like that. So there's different numberings of the commandments, and I just laugh because we always miss a couple because there's 12 or 13, depending on how you count them, because they're not commandments, they're words or things. And so the first word, by my reckoning, is, I am Yahweh your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. In fact, I believe the Jews number that in their number one. They include it in the Ten Commandments. And he says, you shall have no other gods before me. And look what God is doing here. With each of the commandments, since it's easier to see with the second half of the commandments, you know, God gives the gift of life, so don't murder. God gives the gift of marriage and sexuality, so don't commit adultery. God gives the gift of possessions. God gives the gift of, I should be numbering these. God gives the gift of your reputation and name, so don't abuse it. God gives you gratitude and contentment. So enjoy. Enjoy what God has given to you. With each of the commandments, God is giving a gift and protecting it. This deal that he makes with them of saying, you know, you're going to be my people. You're going to be a kingdom of priests. He doesn't say, well, if you do all this stuff first, no. He first gives. He first rescues. He first gives these wonderful gifts of redemption from slavery, deliverance from slavery, rescue from the Egyptian army. And then he gives the gift of life and marriage and possessions and reputation and contentment and thanksgiving. And then says, hey, these are my gifts. You might want to value the gifts that I give to you. And what's the first gift God gives in the 10 words, 10 commandments? The gift of himself. He says, I'm the giver of every good and perfect gift. So don't have any other gods. This is, by the way, in the ancient Near East, this would have been exceptional. There's no comparison. If you chose a god as kind of your god or your people's god, you would worship that god by adding him to your pantheon of gods, which is probably what Abraham did, just added Yahweh to his pantheon of gods and said, hey, this god's my god. That's what normally, but now God says, no, you're going to worship me and me alone. You're not going to have any other gods, just me. I'm the one you saw in the plagues. I control all of creation. I'm the one who delivers good things and can take those good things away. Okay. And then he says, you shall not make for yourself a carved image, which we Lutherans and Catholics don't include that in the list of 10 commandments. I'm going, this is kind of important because who's the image of God? And the answer is us. You see, this commandment to me, I look at it in two directions. One is with regard to God. That is, when we make an image of God, we turn God into an idea or some kind of representation. People do this with love, where it's not that God is love so much as God is kind. And it's not so much God is kind, but God is nice. And so we worship the God of niceness, the nice God. And that's not God. God, if we're going to truly understand God, we have to embrace the fullness of God. I think it was Freud who said, religion is the opiate of the peoples. Indeed. Or more accurately, Calvin said, at least I'm told he said, Calvin said, the human mind is an idol-making factory. God made humans in his image, and we've been returning the favor ever since. We create a God to our own liking. So how do we get to know God? And in this part, God stands off and he's distant and scary. And he sends a human being to represent him to people, because how do we get to know God? Ultimately, it's through other people, not by God directly dealing with us, because God always works through means, the means of grace, and through his people, his priests, his holy nation, his kingdom of priests. That's how God works. It's why God didn't just show up and say, hey, everybody, I'm God. Bow down, serve me, worship me. No, he became flesh. God became flesh and dwelt in our midst. The word of God becomes flesh, dwells in our midst to reveal God to us, because that's what the image of God is. Human beings. The only way we can know who God is through other human beings. Seriously. Yeah, seriously. And ultimately through the one human, Jesus. But then we get to know Jesus through other human beings, because we're the image of God. And then he says, you shall not bow down to those images or serve them, for I, Yahweh, your God, am a jealous or zealous. I like zealous, a zealous God. But there's a part of that. It's not just don't bow down to, false gods, because only to God. We only bow down to God. But there's another part of that, which is, what are we called to do? And God says to Adam and Eve, I've created you in my image, rule, have dominion over, be kings and queens over the land and the animals. Right? Right? Am I right? Genesis 1:28, it's well worth putting into your brain. This is the human story, God turning people into his image bearers, people who reflect God to other human beings and to creation, and to be those intermediaries, mediators between creation and God, between people and God, representing, translating, interpreting, praying for, interceding for, both ways. Which then leads us to the verse 7, Lutheran second commandment, third commandment for you Protestants out there. You shall not take the name of Yahweh your God in vain, meaninglessly. This is often interpreted, one commentator, apparently all the commentators he had, he takes this to mean our words, how we use God's name, whether it's, cursing or blessing or keeping an oath. And I think that's only part of it. The take the name here, it means to bear the name, to have God's name imprinted on us, to take the name the way I took my father's name when I was born. My son took my name when he was born. My wife took my name when she married me. In other words, it makes us part of the family. God placed his name on us in the waters of baptism, the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Ghost. God placed his name on us because we belong to him. You are my people, says God. You carry my name with you. And it's what we pray in the first petition of the Lord's Prayer. Hallowed be thy name. Let your name that you placed upon us in the waters of baptism, let it be holy. Let it be set apart for your purposes. So I hope you're getting this theme of what it means to be priests, image bearers, mediators, a holy nation set apart for God's purpose, our calling, our vocation. Because then we get to chapters 21 through 23, and we have all these, well, ESV translators. Now, these are the rules. It's more like rulings. God does not give statutory law. You know, statutory law is what happens in Washington, D.C. and in Olympia. You know, you have all these lawmakers. The lawmakers make a bunch of rules and regulations and say, do this, don't do that. Maybe some of the rules are okay. Maybe they're good. But they're not human. Because when humans make rulings, when we make judgments, when we mediate, when we act as priests, we act as go-betweens between people and God and between people and people. We don't just go, oh, well, the law says this, so that's what you're going to do. No, we go, no, these are two human beings or a human being and God. And we intercede. We mediate. We go, wait a second here. So here's an example. Wait a second. You killed that guy? Person A killed person B? We value life. You shall not murder. So what do we do with the murderer? We go, a life for a life. You see how we're mediating? We're saying, this is what we value. These are the gifts God has given to us. It's what's called case law, not statutory law or common law. Common law, case law. That's the way we human beings are called by God to make laws. It's more like discovering laws rather than making laws. It's based on the values that God has given to us and our priestly mediatorial role. Because then person A goes, whoa, you know, I didn't murder him. I had no malice aforethought. I didn't intend to kill him. My axe head flew off and it hit him in the head. And we go, oh, okay, well, that's different. It wasn't murder. It was manslaughter. Here's the consequences. You're going to go have to live in the city of refuge, a city of refuge, until the high priest dies. And so we have a bunch of these case laws where we have human beings discovering, if you will, God's rulings, God's judgments as our role as priests and mediators. That's why these rules seem so haphazard, because they're not covering every single contingency. It's more like saying, here's how priests think about these kind of situations. And then one last thing, and it has to do with the tabernacle. I wonder if I can find this because it's so amazingly awesome. I love this line. He says in 25 verse 8, let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell in their midst. That is the whole goal of God's creation story. From Genesis 1 to Revelation 22, God dwelling in the midst of his people. I love that. It just makes me smile. It does. God dwelling in the midst of his people. It's what we pray in the Lord's Prayer when we pray, you know, let God's name be holy in our midst. Let God's kingdom come in our midst. Let God's will be done in our midst. We're praying that God would dwell in the midst of his people and that God's people would be image bearers of God, reflecting God to other people and reflecting people back to God in grateful hymns of praise and thanksgiving and intercession and mediation and saying, this is what God is like, that we are called to show what God is like. And too many Christians, we fall into this trap. And what is God like? He's this judgmental, condemnatory, wrathful God. And you can tell because there's a lot of Christians who are bitter and angry, and that's on a list somewhere in the Bible. It's the list of the fruit of the flesh. No, the works of the flesh. But God is different. God is, you know, we're going to see this next week, you know, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love and compassion, slow to anger. And Moses is going to be showing that in such an amazing way next week. And that's what Jesus does for us. He shows us the way, not the way to, you know, impose God on people, but the way of the cross, where we're willing to sacrifice ourselves for the benefit of others. And Moses does this. Jesus does it most exceptionally on the cross and says, here's how you become human. Come die with me and come live with me. Yes. Good stuff. Good stuff. Join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you chose us to be your image bearers, to be your priests, your mediators, so that we can reflect you to those around us and reflect them back to you in grateful hymns and thanksgivings and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. Amen.